Good morning. Today, I want to talk about a few things that I wish I would have known before I started using NetGalley. Now, if you are unfamiliar with NetGalley or want a little refresher, it is a website where publishers pay to have their books hosted on the platform. Anyone can make an account, it's free to sign up, and then once they fill out their bio and some other relevant information, they can start requesting books. Now, just because you request a book, and the majority of these books are upcoming releases, new releases, debut novels, that does not mean you will automatically be approved. People at the publishing houses, and these are like the big five, soon to be big four publishing houses, and tons of small indie presses as well, look at your profile and decide if they want to give you an advanced review copy or an ARC of the book in exchange for what they call an insightful review, or in some cases, a thoughtful and candid review. I put those in quotations because those seem to mean different things to different people, but I digress. And one of the ways they decide if they want to give out a book, besides the some of the kind of technical stuff about what territory you're in or how many books they have to give out or how close the deadline is from when the book is going to be released, since normally they want you to have the reviews out before a book is put out to the public, is your feedback ratio. And your feedback ratio is basically taking the number of books you've been approved for and then looking at the number of books you have actually reviewed to get a percentage. And they like you to be around 80%. On top of that, though, you also have your bio. And your bio can have a lot of different things. They tell you that if you're a librarian or an educator, part of certain societies, put that stuff in there. If you're someone who does, independent reviews online and has a social media following, put some of your stats there. Because those things combined, as well with your track record, the types of reviews you put out before, will have an influence on what kind of books you get approved for and how many books you get approved for. So with that overall message, I made a NetGalley account months ago and promptly forgot about it. I think I just got kind of caught up in the hype of all like the new BookTube, book community stuff. And I just, kept reading the books that were on my shelf. The majority of the books I read are backlisted books. However, since this year, I'm really trying not to buy any books in 2021, with a few exceptions. I thought this would be a great like tool to brush up on my writing skills, but also to read new books I wouldn't have been able to read otherwise, and to try some new releases. Because I will say, although I love my Toni Morrison, my Octavia Butler, my Robert Dee Sansucci, I do want to be more up to date on some newer, younger, contemporary authors who are making, making waves and making a splash on the scene right now. So I'm going to share a couple things I wish I would have known before I started using NetGalley consistently. Maybe this only reveals my bias and my blind spots, but hopefully they'll be helpful to other people. First is what to put in your bio. Now, as someone who has a smaller community, a smaller platform as compared to, I would say, some of the biggest, not even the biggest creators, but like mid-tier creators on the platform. At first, I thought that my numbers wouldn't be necessary or wouldn't be impressive, but I was surprised to find that I started getting approved for more books when I did put that I had X amount of subscribers, X amount of views, and I decided to add X amount of growth per month. And growth, I use channels instead of views because I thought that'd be simpler, and because the number of subscribers I get per month tends to be pretty consistent. Now, I don't know for sure if that is a deciding factor for some folks. All I can say is that once I was specific about the numbers on my channel, and I'm sure that could apply to numbers on a blog or numbers on Instagram or a book TikTok account, I started getting approved for more books. So I would say, even if you feel like your audience is too small to count, because there are some publishers that explicitly say on the site they're not interested in working with people who have less than X amount of thousand followers, put it in there. What can it hurt? The second thing I learned was that every time you go back to edit a feedback you've already sent, it will resend it to the publisher to be reapproved. Now, that may seem like obvious to other people, but at the time I was writing these reviews, and then I would think about things for a couple more days and want to go back and add a line, or go back and add more content warnings, or go back and reword something. And I didn't understand why my feedback ratio was going from like 100 to 0, 100 to 0. And it was because I did not clock at first that every time I changed something, even if it was something small, it was ge getting the whole review was getting like resent to be reapproved. And I feel so bad about that now, because I'm sure I was making more work for, I don't know, whatever poor intern has to read these things. And it also was making my score look really ridiculous, like fluctuating up and down every day. So if you're someone like me who tends to write their reviews like the day of or the day after you read the book, sit on it for a couple of days, let it sit in your Word document before you decide to put it up. Of course, if you make a mistake, like the edit button is there for a reason, but do not make my mistake and think that you can edit for as long as you want without it affecting other things on the platform. The third thing that I wish I had known before I started using NetGalley was that there is no consistent place to find content warnings. Now, once you make an account and you click on a book, if other people on NetGalley have already reviewed that book, you can see their reviews. So oftentimes, if a book had other reviews, I would scroll through to try to get an idea of what it was about beyond the marketing blurb, see if there was content I need to be aware of. But not every book is like that. One book that I just read, my feedback is the first thing up there, because I just happened to be the first person who requested it, who decided to give feedback. And it was a book that had very intense subject matter involving violence against a child. Now, I still overall enjoyed the book. It was a thriller. I enjoyed the writing. But if I had known that ahead of time, I probably wouldn't have picked it up. There are certain things I can read, certain things I can't read, and of course, how an author handles the content is very, very important. And just, yeah, when it comes to kids, that's, I don't really like that in my fictional content. By the time that I figured that out, I was already a certain portion into the book. I was invested and did want to figure out how it ended, so good on the author for that. But that's just a decision I probably would have made differently if I had more information. So and I say that not to say that you should never request a book on NetGalley that doesn't have reviews yet. You might have a higher chance of getting that book if it's something that's not very highly requested. But I do wish that the NetGalley website had a place where you consistently found content warnings or trigger warnings beyond what might be, you know, in the marketing blurbs or the marketing brief. Moving on to ways to get ARCs or ways to build up your score is that maybe because I was using the website on my phone at first, there really isn't like a mobile version of the site. You just kind of, you know, go to Google and figure it out. The NetGalley app is more about reading the books as opposed to browsing. I somehow missed in the toolbar that there is a whole category of books that you don't need to be approved to read. If you're looking at NetGalley and you're on it on a desktop, or I guess if I put my phone on horizontal mode, on the left-hand side, you'll see there is a little tab that just says read now. And any book in that section, you can read, download, and review without waiting to be approved by the publisher. And so when I first started, I was wondering why it was taking so long for me to get approved for books, assuming it was because of the fact that I had a 0% NetGalley score and, you know, a small following online. But once I realized that there was a section where I could just read something I was interested in and then write a review to one, get up my score, but to also show that I'm a strong writer and I have valuable opinions, I was getting approved so much faster after only 4 or 5 books in that section. So those are just like a couple of tips that are a couple of things that I wish I would have known before I started using NetGalley. And as I said, I've only been using it like consistently for the last several weeks or so. So you'll start to see a lot more of these NetGalley ARCs popping up in my wrap-ups. But I just wanted to do a quick little video in the hopes that there might be someone else out there who's at the very beginning of their NetGalley journey, trying to figure out how it works, trying to figure out if it's for them. And hopefully I can prevent you from making some of the same mistakes I have made. And then maybe if I continue doing it, if I continue enjoying it, I can check in like 6 months or a year even and see what else I have learned, if I still value the website and if I still feel like it's a fair trade-off. If you are someone who is already using NetGalley and has some advice for me or things I don't know, please let me know in the comments below. And if you're not someone who's ever used it, consider checking it out. I will say I've enjoyed how much more varied my reading has gotten, because I'm like, why not? Let's try this thriller. Why not? Let's try this, you know, gripping, hard-hitting tale about friendship struggling through the opioid crisis. Like books that I probably wouldn't have gravitated towards in a library in a bookstore, because I know it's a risk-free endeavor. If I don't like it, I just write a review explaining why I don't like it. I feel like a lot more freedom because I don't have to put in the monetary investment, and I can just scroll in the privacy of my home and then download the books to my computer. But anyway, I am rambling.